First of all, people have for a long time thought that this happened just in one region of the world, in the so-called Fertile Crescent. Now we know agricultural food production has happened in many different parts of the world. You know, New Guinea is another famous place where it has happened. There are parts in Africa. It's certainly mice is another example where it has happened. But wherever it has happened, it has allowed the local populations to significantly expand and to deeply shape their environments in such a way that they could take part of their environments with them.
And if you look at strategies to overcome the various challenges that we face in terms of sustainability, it all boils down to we need the right kind of innovation. Nobody seems to realize that we are only in the dilemma that we are facing because of centuries of unchecked innovation. And if you think about what innovations do to those highly interconnected systems that you heard in the context of the technosphere and of the distribution of resources, what innovations do is they generate unintended consequences. And it's an interesting problem of understanding the dynamics of evolutionary and co-evolutionary dynamics of complex systems as to what is the scale of innovation to unintended consequences.
Of course, humans are essential. If humans went away, then the whole technology, the technosphere would go away. But of course, the converse is also true. If technology went away, basically 99.9% of the people would go away as well.
We shouldn't also restrict ourselves, I believe, to the actors on the one hand and the material world on the other. There's an institutional world, there's an economic world, and much of the technosphere is the product of economic processes, of industrialization, of capitalism.
It's this idea that in a way technology runs itself and the human agency has little to do with how we progress. And that's the idea of the Moore's Law, that you just keep growing without any possibility for us as human society to avoid this kind of growth. Mm-hmm. And it's very much in the line that our colleague Manfred mentioned in the beginning, the idea of the concept of innovation itself. If innovation means necessarily bad management of resources, or if innovation can mean something that doesn't have to do with, for instance, this capitalistic way of approaching resources.
With the relation between industrial revolution and capitalism, what comes first? Well, how are they related? How is related a new form of economics, a new form of economical developments and organization of the economical and social structure of society to the development of industrialization? And these are crucial issues.
Is there just one pathway through industrialization? Were there historical alternatives to it? Yeah. And then is the kind of industrial agriculture using phosphor and using nitrogen, is that an unavoidable consequences of the Industrial Revolution? People at the time, before they found nitrate-based fertilizers, were thinking that they had a major problem possibly bringing the end of humanity because so many people would be starving.
The question that emerged in the 20th century around whether or not human beings could cause extinction. And, of course, that conversation emerges, I mean, it has an older history around millennial thought and apocalyptic thought, but it particularly emerges around nuclear weapons. And I think the history of the sort of the way that gets worked out is at this institutional collective level where sort of people said, well, what will keep us from doing that? Consciousness, well, a few, you know, people with a consciousness can decide to drop an atomic bomb on a city. So it has to be one level up. It has to be either physicists working across borders, or it has to be the state or an international body, whatever it may be.
I think it is quite important that we reflect about who do we want to do what with the concept of the Anthropocene once it leaves these four walls and just, you know, our disciplinary discussion, which is why, you know, we had the discussion about states, about essentially scales of action. The state level of analysis is a level of analysis that incorporates certain divisions. And in order to speak about attribution of responsibility, which is essentially creating categories of duty bearers and of right holders, you need division of into groups. And if you use a language of commonality, it is mutually exclusive to an adversarial language where, you know, the all the justice and fairness issues can be tackled. Whether the current political international the current structure and composition of the international political sphere, whether it is appropriate or not to tackle this matter, is not really the point. It is just the world as it is today. It is a world that is going to receive this concept.